The Story of Civilization, Volume 1, Our Oriental Heritage, Part 2, by Will Durant, continued, Cassette 8, Side 2. Just as in Chinese religion, two schools had taken shape, Confucian and Taoist Buddhist, and just as two schools, led by Chu Xi and Wang Yangming, were soon to develop in philosophy, representing respectively what we in the West would call the classic and the romantic types of mind, so in Chinese painting, the northern artists accepted a stern tradition of classical sobriety and restraint, while the south gave color and form to feeling and imagination. The northern school set itself severely to secure correct modeling of figure and full clarity of line. The southern rebelled like Montmartre against such limitations, disdained a simple realism, and tried to use objects merely as elements in a spiritual experience, tones in a musical mood. Li Su-shun, painting at the court of Ming Huang, found time amid the fluctuations of political power and lonely exile to establish the northern school. He painted some of the first Chinese landscapes and achieved a degree of realism carried down in many a tale. The emperor said he could hear at night the splash of the water that Li had painted upon an imperial screen, and a fish leaped to life out of another of his pictures and was later found in a pool. Every nation tells such stories of its painters. The southern school sprouted out of the natural innovations of art and the genius of Wang Wei. In his impressionist style, a landscape became merely the symbol of a mood. A poet as well as a painter, Wang sought to bind the two arts by making the picture express a poem. It was of him that men first used the now trite phrase, so applicable to nearly all Chinese poetry and painting. Every poem is a picture, and every picture is a poem. In many cases, the poem is inscribed upon the picture and is itself a calligraphic work of art. Tung Chi Chang, we are told, spent his whole life searching for a genuine Wang Wei. The greatest painter of the Tang epoch, and by common consent of all the Far East, rose above distinctions of school and belonged rather to the Buddhist tradition of Chinese art. Wu Taotse deserved his name, Wu, Master of the Tao, or Wei, for all those impressions and formless thoughts which Lao Tse and Chuang Tse had found too subtle for words seemed to flow naturally into line and color under his brush. A poverty-stricken orphan, a Chinese historian describes him, but endowed with a divine nature, he had not assumed the cap of puberty ere he was already a master artist and had flooded Luoyang with his works. Chinese tradition has it that he was fond of wine and feats of strength, and thought like Po that the spirit could work best under a little intoxication. He excelled in every subject, men, gods, devils, Buddhas, birds, beasts, buildings, landscapes, all seemed to come naturally to his exuberant art. He painted with equal skill on silk, paper, and freshly plastered walls. He made 300 frescoes for Buddhist edifices, and one of these, containing more than 1,000 figures, became as famous in China as the Last Judgment or the Last Supper in Europe. 93 of his paintings were in the Imperial Gallery in the 12th century, 400 years after his death, but none remains anywhere today. His Buddhas, we are told, fathomed the mysteries of life and death. His picture of purgatory frightened some of the butchers and fishmongers of China into abandoning their scandalously un-Buddhistic trades. His representation of Ming Huang's dream convinced the emperor that Wu had had an identical vision. When the monarch sent Wu to sketch the scenery along the Chaling River in Sichuan, he was piqued to see the artist return without having sketched a line. "I have it all in my heart," said Wu, and isolating himself in a room off the palace, he threw off, we are assured, 100 miles of landscape. When General Pei wished his portrait painted, Wu asked him not to pose, but to do a sword dance, after which the artist painted a picture that contemporaries felt constrained to ascribe to divine inspiration. So great was his reputation that when he was finishing some Buddhist figures at the Xingshan Temple, the whole of Chang'an came to see him add the finishing touches. Surrounded by this assemblage, says a Chinese historian of the 9th century, he executed the halos with so violent a rush and swirl that it seemed as though a whirlwind possessed his hand, and all who saw it cried that some god was helping him. The lazy will always attribute genius to some inspiration that comes for mere waiting. When Wu had lived long enough, says a pretty tale, he painted a vast landscape, stepped into the mouth of a cave pictured in it, and was never seen again. Never had art known such mastery and delicacy of line. Under the Song emperors, painting became a passion with the Chinese. Emancipating itself from subserviency to Buddhist themes, it poured forth an unprecedented number and variety of pictures. The Song emperor Wei Zong was himself not the least of 800 known painters of the day. In a role which is one of the treasures of the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, he portrayed with astonishing simplicity and clarity the stages through which women carried the preparation of silk. he founded an art museum richer in masterpieces than any collection that China has ever again known. He elevated the Painting Academy from a mere department of the Literary College into an independent institution of the highest rank, substituted art tests for some of the literary exercises traditionally used in the examinations for political office, and raised men to the ministry for their excellence in art as often as for their skill in statesmanship. The Tatars, hearing of all this, invaded China, deposed the emperor, sacked the capital, and destroyed nearly all of the paintings in the Imperial Museum, whose catalog had filled 20 volumes. The artist emperor was carried away by the invaders and died in captivity and disgrace. Greater than this royal painter were Kuo Shi and Li Lunmian. For tall pines, huge trees, swirling streams, beetling crags, steep precipices, mountain peaks, now lovely in the rising mist, now lost in an obscuring pall, with all their 1,000, 10,000 shapes, critics allow that Kuo Shi strode across his generation. The Freer Gallery at Washington has a landscape on the Huang Ho, uncertainly attributed to Kuo Shi. Li Lunmian was an artist, a scholar, a successful official, and a gentleman, honored by the Chinese as the perfect type of Chinese culture at its richest. He passed from the profession of calligraphy to sketching and painting, and rarely used anything but ink. He gloried in the strict traditions of the Northern school, and spent himself upon accuracy and delicacy of line. He painted horses so well that when six that he had painted died, it was charged that his picture had stolen their vital principle from them. A Buddhist priest warned him that he would become a horse if he painted horses so often and so intently. He accepted the counsel of the monk and painted 500 Lohans. We may judge of his repute by the fact that Hui Tsung's Imperial Gallery, when it was sacked, contained 107 works by Li Lunmian. Other masters crowded the Tsung scene. Mi Fei, an eccentric genius who was forever washing his hands or changing his clothes when he was not collecting old masters or transforming landscape painting with his method of blobs, daubs of ink laid on with the guidance of any contour line. A landscape attributed to Mi Fei may be seen in room E11 of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Xia Kuei, whose long roll of scenes from the Yangtze, its modest sources, its passage through less and gorges, its gaping mouth filled with merchant ships and sampans, has led many students to rank him at the head of all landscape painters of Orient and Occident. Ma Yuan, whose delicate landscapes and distant vistas adorn the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. Particularly striking is the Lady Ling Chao standing in the snow. The lady, a Buddhist mystic of the 8th century, is quite still in meditation, like Socrates in the snow at Plataea. The world, the artist seems to say, is nothing except to a mind, and that mind can ignore it for a while. Liang Kai, with his stately portrait of Li Po, Mu Qi, with his terrible tiger, his careless starling, and his morose but gentle Kuan Yin, and others whose names strike no familiar chords in Occidental memories, but are the tokens of a mind rich in the heritage of the East. The Sung culture, says Feniosa, was the ripest expression of Chinese genius. When we try to estimate the quality of Chinese painting in the heyday of Tang and Sung, we are in the position of future historians who may try to write of the Italian Renaissance, when all the works of Raphael, Leonardo, and Michelangelo have been lost. After the ravages of barbaric hosts had destroyed the masterpieces of Chinese painting and interrupted for centuries the continuity of Chinese development, painting seems to have lost heart. And though the later dynasties, native and alien, produced many artists of delicacy or power, none could rank with the men who had known paradise for a time at the courts of Ming Huang and Hui Tsung. When we think of the Chinese, we must see them not merely as a people now stricken with poverty, weakened with corruption, torn with factions and disgraced with defeat, but as a nation that has had, in the long vista of its history, ages that could compare with those of Pericles, Augustus, and the Medici, and may have such ages again. 2. Qualities of Chinese painting. The rejection of perspective, of realism, line as nobler than color, form as rhythm, representation by suggestion, conventions and restrictions, sincerity of Chinese art. What is it that distinguishes Chinese painting and makes it so completely different from every other school of painting in history except its own pupils in Japan? First, of course, its scroll or screen form. But this is an external matter. Far more intrinsic and fundamental is the Chinese scorn of perspective and shadow. When two European painters accepted the invitation of the Emperor Kangxi to come and paint decorations for his palaces, their work was rejected because they had made the farther columns in their pictures shorter than the nearer ones. Nothing could be more false and artificial, argued the Chinese, than to represent distances where obviously there were none. Neither party could understand the prejudice of the other, for the Europeans had been taught to look at a scene from a level with it, while the Chinese artists were accustomed to visualize it as seen from above. Shadows, too, seemed to the Chinese to be out of place in a form of art which, as they understood it, aimed not to imitate reality but to give pleasure, convey moods, and suggest ideas through the medium of perfect form. The form was everything in these paintings, and it was sought not in warmth or splendor of color, but in rhythm and accuracy of line. In the early paintings, color was sternly excluded, and in the masters it was rare. Black ink and a brush were enough, for a color had nothing to do with form. Form, as the artist-theorist Xie Ho said, is rhythm. First, in the sense that a Chinese painting is the visible record of a rhythmic gesture, a dance executed by the hand. And again, in the sense that a significant form reveals the rhythm of the spirit, the essence and quiet movement of reality. Finally, the body of rhythm is line, not as describing the actual contours of things, but as building forms that, through suggestion or symbol, express the soul. The skill of execution, as distinct from the power of perception, feeling, and imagination, lies in Chinese painting almost entirely in accuracy and delicacy of line. The painter must observe with patient care, possess intense feeling under strict control, conceive his purpose clearly, and then, without the possibility of correction, transfer to the silk with a few continuous and easeful strokes his representative imagination. The art of line reached its apex in China and Japan, as the art of color touched its zenith in Venice and the Netherlands. Chinese painting never cared for realism, but sought rather to suggest than to describe. It left truth to science and gave itself to beauty. A branch emerging nowhence and bearing a few leaves or blossoms against a clear sky was sufficient subject for the greatest master. His handling and proportion of the empty background were tests of his courage and his skill. One of the subjects proposed to candidates for admission to Wei Tsung's Painting Academy may serve to illustrate the Chinese emphasis on indirect suggestion as against explicit representation. The contestants were asked to illustrate by paintings a line of poetry. The hoof of his steed comes back heavily charged with the scent of the trampled flowers. The successful competitor was an artist who painted a rider with a cluster of butterflies following at the horse's heels. As the form was everything, the subject might be anything. Men were rarely the center or essence of the picture. When they appeared, they were almost always old and nearly all alike. The Chinese painter, though he was never visibly a pessimist, seldom looked at the world through the eyes of youth. Portraits were painted, but indifferently well. The artist was not interested in individuals. He loved flowers and animals, apparently far more than men, and spent himself upon them recklessly. Hui Tsung, with an empire at his command, gave half his life to painting birds and flowers. Sometimes the flowers or the animals were symbols, like the lotus or the dragon. But for the most part they were drawn for their own sake, because the charm and mystery of life appeared as completely in them as in a man. The horse was especially loved, and artists like Han Kang did hardly anything else but paint one form after another of that living embodiment of artistic line. It is true that painting suffered in China, first from religious conventions and then from academic restrictions, that the copying and imitation of old masters became a retarding fetish in the training of students, and that the artist was in many matters confined to a given number of permitted ways of fashioning his material. "In my young days," said an eminent Sung critic, "I praised the master whose pictures I liked, but as my judgment matured I praised myself for liking what the masters had chosen to have me like." It is astonishing how much vitality remained in this art, despite its conventions and canons. It was here, as Hume thought it had been with the censored writers of the French Enlightenment. The very limitations from which the artist suffered compelled him to be brilliant. What saved the Chinese painters from stagnation was the sincerity of their feeling for nature. Taoism had taught it to them, and Buddhism had made it stronger by teaching them that man and nature are one in the flow and change and unity of life. As the poets found in nature a retreat from urban strife, and the philosophers sought in it a model of morals and a guide to life, so the painters brooded by solitary streams and lost themselves in deeply wooded hills, feeling that in these speechless and lasting things the nameless spirit had expressed itself more clearly than in the turbulent career and thought of men. Landscape painting was called simply Shan Sui, that is, mountains and water. Nature, which is so cruel in China, lavishing death with cold and flood, was accepted stoically as the supreme god of the Chinese, and received from them not merely religious sacrifice, but the worship of their philosophy, their literature, and their art. Let it serve as an indication of the age and depth of culture in China, that 1,000 years before Claude Lorraine, Rousseau, Wordsworth, and Chateaubriand, the Chinese made nature a passion and created a school of landscape painting whose work throughout the Far East became one of the sovereign expressions of mankind. 5. Porcelain. The ceramic art, the making of porcelain, its early history, céladon, enamels, the skill of Hao Shi Qiu, cloisonné, the age of Kangxi, of Qianlong. As we approach the most distinct art of China, in which her leadership of the world is least open to dispute, we find ourselves harassed by our tendency to class pottery as an industry. To us, accustomed to think of China in terms of the kitchen, a pottery is a place where China is made. It is a factory like any other, and its products do not arouse exalted associations. But to the Chinese, pottery was a major art. It pleased their practical and yet aesthetic souls by combining beauty with use. It gave to their greatest national institution, the drinking of tea, utensils as lovely to the fingertips as to the eye, and it adorned their homes with shapes so fair that even the poorest families might live in the presence of perfection. Pottery is the sculpture of the Chinese. Pottery is, first, the industry that bakes clay into usable forms, second, the art that makes those forms beautiful, and third, the objects produced by that industry and that art. Porcelain is vitrified pottery. That is, it is clay so mixed with minerals that when exposed to fire it melts or fuses into a translucent but not transparent substance resembling glass. When porcelain was introduced into Europe, it was named after the porcellana, or cowrie shell, which in turn derived its name from its supposed resemblance to the rounded back of a porcella, or little hog. The Chinese made porcelain out of two minerals chiefly, kaolin, a pure white clay formed from decomposed feldspar of granite, and peituntse, a fusible white quartz that gave the product its translucency. These materials were ground into a powder, worked up into a paste with water, molded by hand or on the wheel, and subjected to high temperatures that fused the composition into a vitreous form, brilliant and durable. Sometimes the potters, not content with this simple white porcelain, covered the paste, that is, the vessel formed but not yet fired, with a glaze or coating of fine glass, and then placed the vessel in the kiln. Sometimes they applied the glaze after baking the paste into a biscuit, and then placed the vessel over the fire again. Usually the glaze was colored, but in many cases the paste was painted in color before applying a transparent glaze, or colors were painted on the fired glaze and fused upon it by refiring. These over-glaze colors, which we call enamels, were made of colored glass ground to powder and reduced to a liquid applicable with the painter's slender brush. Life-trained specialists painted the flowers, others the animals, others the landscapes, others the saints or sages who meditated among the mountains or rode upon strange beasts over the waves of the sea. Chinese pottery is as old as the Stone Age. Professor Anderson has found pottery in Honan and Kansu, which can hardly be later in time than 3000 BC. And the excellent form and finish of these vases assure us that even at this early date, the industry had long since become an art. Some of the pieces resemble the pottery of Anao and suggest a Western origin for Chinese civilization. Far inferior to these Neolithic products are the fragments of funerary pottery unearthed in Honan and ascribed to the declining years of the Shang dynasty. No remains of artistic value appear again before the Han, when we find not only pottery but the first known use of glass in the Far East. The Egyptians had glazed pottery unknown centuries before Christ. The decorations on the earliest glazed pottery of China indicate that China had learned the glazing process from the Near East. Under the Tang emperors, the growing popularity of tea provided a creative stimulus for the ceramic art. Genius or accident revealed about the 9th century the possibility of producing a vessel vitrified not only on the glazed surface, as under the Han and in other civilizations before this age, but throughout, that is, true porcelain. In that century, a Muslim traveler, Suleiman, reported to his countrymen, "They have in China a very fine clay with which they make vases as transparent as glass. Water is seen through them." Excavations have recently discovered on a 9th century site at Samarra on the Tigris pieces of porcelain of Chinese manufacture. The next recorded appearance of the substance outside of China was about 1171, when Saladin sent 41 pieces of porcelain as a precious gift to the Sultan of Damascus. The manufacture of porcelain is not known to have begun in Europe before 1470. It is mentioned then as an art which the Venetians had learned from the Arabs in the course of the Crusades. Sung was the classic period of Chinese porcelain. Ceramists ascribed to it both the oldest extant wares and the best. Even the Ming potters of a later age, who sometimes equaled them, spoke of Sung pottery in reverential terms, and collectors treasured its masterpieces as beyond any price. The great factories at Qingdezhen, founded in the 6th century near rich deposits of the minerals used for making and coloring earthenware, were officially recognized by the imperial court and began to pour out upon China an unprecedented stream of porcelain, plates, cups, bowls, vases, beakers, jars, bottles, ewers, boxes, chessboards, candlesticks, maps, even enameled and gold-inlaid porcelain hat racks. Now for the first time appeared those jade-green pieces known as céladon, a term applied to them by the French of the 17th century from the name of the hero of Durfé's novel L'Astrée, who in the dramatization of the story was always dressed in green, which it has long been the highest ambition of the modern potter to produce and of the collector to acquire. From the Occidental point of view, the one is as hard as the other, for the Japanese, who have gathered in most of China's famous céladon, refuse to sell it at any price, and no later potter has been able to rival the perfection of Sung artistry in this field. Specimens of it were sent to Lorenzo de' Medici by the Sultan of Egypt in 1487. The Persians and the Turks valued it not only for its incredibly smooth texture and rich luster, but as a detector of poisons. The vessels would change color, they believed, whenever poisonous substances were placed in them. Pieces of céladon are handed down from generation to generation as priceless heirlooms in the families of connoisseurs. For almost 300 years, the workers of the Ming dynasty labored to keep the art of porcelain on the high level to which the Sung potters had raised it, and they did not fall far short of success. 500 kilns burned at Qingdezhen, and the imperial court alone used 96,000 pieces of chinaware to adorn its gardens, its tables, and its rooms. Now appeared the first good enamels, colors fired over the glaze. Yellow monochromes and eggshell blue and white porcelains reached perfection. The blue-and-white silver-mounted cup named from the Emperor Wan Li, or Shen Sung, is one of the world's masterpieces of the potter's art. Among the experts of the Wan Li age was Hao Shi Chu, who could make wine cups weighing less than 1/48th of an ounce. One day, says a Chinese historian, Hao called at the home of a high official and begged permission to examine a porcelain tripod owned by the statesman and numbered among the choicest of Sung wares. Hao felt the tripod carefully with his hands and secretly copied the form of its design on a paper concealed in his sleeve. 6 months later he visited the official again and said, "Your Excellency is the possessor of a tripod censer of white ting yao," the name given by the Chinese to an ivory-colored species of Sung porcelain. "Here is a similar one of mine." Tang, the official, compared the new tripod with his own and could detect no difference. Even the stand and cover of the tripod fitted Hao's completely. Hao smilingly admitted that his own piece was an imitation, and then sold it for 60 pieces of silver to Tang, who sold it for 1,500. It was under the Mings that Chinese cloisonné attained its highest excellence. Both the word and the art came from the outside, the word from the French cloison, partition, the art from the Near East of Byzantine days. The Chinese referred to its products occasionally as kuei kuo yao, wares of the devil's country. The art consists in cutting narrow strips of copper, silver, or gold, soldering them edgewise upon the lines of a design previously drawn upon a metal object, filling the spaces between the cloison, or wire lines, with appropriately colored enamel, exposing the vessel repeatedly to fire, grinding the hardened surface with pumice stone, polishing it with charcoal, and gilding the visible edges of the cloison. The earliest known Chinese examples are some mirrors imported into Nara, Japan, about the middle of the 8th century. The oldest wares definitely marked belong to the end of the Mongol or Yuan dynasty, the best to the reign of the Ming Emperor Qing Ti. The last great period of Chinese cloisonné was under the great Manchu emperors of the 18th century. The factories at Qingdezhen were destroyed in the wars that ended the Ming dynasty and were not revived again until the accession of one of China's most enlightened rulers, Kangxi, who, quite as much as his contemporary Louis XIV, was every inch a king. The factories at Qingdezhen were rebuilt under his direction, and soon 3,000 furnaces were in operation. Never had China or any other country seen such an abundance of elegant pottery. The Kangxi workers thought their wares inferior to those of Ming, but modern connoisseurs do not agree with them. Old forms were imitated perfectly, and new forms were developed in rich diversity. By coating a paste with a glaze of a different tempo of fusibility, the Manchu potters produced the prickly surface of crackleware. And by blowing bubbles of paint upon the glaze, they turned out souffle wares covered with little circles of color. They mastered the art of monochrome and issued peach bloom, coral, ruby, vermilion, sang de boeuf, and rose de berry reds, cucumber, apple, peacock, grass, and celadon greens, mazarin, azure, lilac, and turquoise, or kingfisher blues, and yellows and whites of such velvet texture that one could only describe them as smoothness made visible. They created ornate styles distinguished by French collectors as famille rose, famille verte, famille noire, and famille jaune, rose, green, black, and yellow families. Excellent specimens of the last two groups may be seen at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. In the field of polychromes, they developed the difficult art of subjecting a vessel in the kiln to alternate drafts of clear and soot-laden air, the first providing, the second withdrawing, oxygen, in such ways that the green glaze was transformed into a flame of many colors, so that the French have called this variety flambé. They painted upon some of their wares high officials in flowing queue-and robes and created the Mandarin style. They painted flowers of the plum in white upon a blue, less often a black, background, and gave to the world the grace and delicacy of the hawthorn vase. The last great age of Chinese porcelain came in the long and prosperous reign of Qianlong. Fertility was undiminished, and though the new forms had something less than the success of the Kangxi innovations, the skill of the master potters was still supreme. The famille rose attained its fullest perfection and spread half the flowers and fruits of nature over the most brilliant glaze, while eggshell porcelain provided costly lampshades for extravagant millionaires. Then, through 15 bloody years, 1850 to 1864, came the Taiping Rebellion, ruining 15 provinces, destroying 600 cities, killing 20 million men and women, and so impoverishing the Manchu dynasty that it withdrew its support from the potteries and allowed them to close their doors and scatter their craftsmen into a disordered world. The art of porcelain in China has not recovered from that devastation, and perhaps it never will, for other factors have reinforced the destructiveness of war and the ending of imperial patronage. The growth of the export trade tempted the artists to design such pieces as best satisfied the taste of European buyers, and as their taste was not as fine as the Chinese, the bad pieces drove the good pieces out of circulation by a ceramic variation of Gresham's law. About the year 1840, English factories began to make inferior porcelain at Canton and exported it to Europe and gave it the name of Chinaware. Factories at Sèvres in France, Meissen in Germany, and Burslem in England imitated the work of the Chinese, lowered the cost of production by installing machinery, and captured yearly more and more of China's foreign ceramic trade. What survives is the memory of an art perhaps as completely lost as that of medieval stained glass. Try as they will, the potters of Europe have been unable to equal the subtler forms of Chinese porcelain. Connoisseurs raise with every decade their monetary estimate of the masterpieces that survive. They ask $500 for a teacup and receive $23,600 for a hawthorn vase. As far back as 1767, two turquoise porcelain dogs of Faux at auction brought five times as much as Guido Reni's Infant Jesus and thrice as much as Raphael's Holy Family. But anyone who has felt with eyes and fingers and every nerve the loveliness of Chinese porcelain will resent these valuations and count them as sacrilege. The world of beauty and the world of money never touch, even when beautiful things are sold. It is enough to say that Chinese porcelain is the summit and symbol of Chinese civilization, one of the noblest things that men have done to make their species forgivable on the earth. Chapter 26. The People and the State. 1. Historical Interlude. 1. Marco Polo visits Kublai Khan. The Incredible Travelers, Adventures of a Venetian in China, The Elegance and Prosperity of Hang Chau, The Palaces of Peking, The Mongol Conquest, Genghis Khan, Kublai Khan, His Character and Policy, His Harem, Marco Millions. In the Golden Age of Venice, about the year 1295, two old men and a man of middle age, worn with hardship, laden with bundles, dressed in rags and covered with the dust of many roads, begged and then forced their way into the home from which they claimed they had set forth 26 years before. They had, they said, sailed many dangerous seas, scaled high mountains and plateaus, crossed bandit-ridden deserts, and passed four times through the Great Wall. They had stayed 20 years in Cathay, and had served the mightiest monarch in the world. They told of an empire vaster, of cities more populous, and of a ruler far richer than any known to Europe, of stones that were used for heating, of paper accepted in place of gold, and of nuts larger than a man's head, of nations where virginity was an impediment to marriage, and of others where strangers were entertained by the free use of the host's willing daughters and wives. No man would believe them, and the people of Venice gave to the youngest and most garrulous of them the nickname Marco Millions, because his tale was full of numbers large and marvelous. Mark and his father and uncle accepted this fate with good cheer, for they had brought back with them many precious stones from the distant capital, and these gave them such wealth as maintained them in high place in their city. When Venice went to war with Genoa in 1298, Marco Polo received command of a galley, and when his ship was captured and he was kept for a year in a Genoese jail, he consoled himself by dictating to an amanuensis the most famous travel book in literature. He told with the charm of a simple and straightforward style how he, Father Niccolo, and Uncle Maffeo had left Acre when Mark was but a boy of 17, how they had climbed over the Lebanon ranges and found their way through Mesopotamia to the Persian Gulf, and thence through Persia, Khorasan, and Balkh to the plateau of Pamir, how they had joined caravans that slowly marched to Kashgar and Khotan, and across the Gobi Desert to Tangut, and through the wall to Shangtu, where the great Khan received them as humble emissaries from the youthful West. Shangtu is Coleridge's Xanadu. The Central Asian regions described by Polo were not explored again by Europeans, with one forgotten exception, until 1838. They had not thought that they would stay in China beyond a year or two, but they found such lucrative service and commercial opportunities under Kublai that they remained almost a quarter of a century. Marco, above all, prospered, rising even to be governor of Hangzhou. In fond memory, he describes it as far ahead of any European city, in the excellence of its buildings and bridges, the number of its public hospitals, the elegance of its villas, the profusion of facilities for pleasure and vice, the charm and beauty of its courtesans, the effective maintenance of public order, and the manners and refinement of its people. The city, he tells us, was 100 miles in circuit. Its streets and canals are extensive, and of sufficient width to allow of boats on the one and carriages on the other to pass easily with articles necessary for the inhabitants. It is commonly said that the number of bridges of all sizes amounts to 12,000. Those which are thrown over the principal canals and are connected with the main streets have arches so high and built with so much skill that vessels with their masts can pass under them. At the same time, carts and horses can pass over, so well is the slope from the street graded to the height of the arch. There are within the city 10 principal squares or marketplaces, besides innumerable shops along the streets. Each side of these squares is a half mile in length, and in front of them is the main street, 40 paces in width, and running in a direct line from one extremity of the city to the other. In a direction parallel to that of the main street runs a very large canal, on the nearer bank of which capacious warehouses are built of stone, for the accommodation of the merchants who arrive from India and other parts with their goods and effects. They are thus conveniently situated with respect to the marketplaces. In each of these, upon 3 days in every week, there is an assemblage of from 40,000 to 50,000 persons. The streets are all paved with stone and bricks. The main street of the city is paved to the width of 10 paces on each side, the intermediate part being filled up with small gravel and provided with arched drains for carrying off the rainwater that falls into the neighboring canals, so that it remains always dry. On this gravel, carriages continually pass and repass. They are of a long shape, covered at the top, have curtains and cushions of silk, and are capable of holding 6 persons. Both men and women who feel disposed to take their pleasure are in the daily practice of hiring them for that purpose. There is an abundant quantity of game of all kinds. From the sea, which is 15 miles distant, there is daily brought up the river to the city a vast quantity of fish. At the sight of such an importation of fish, you would think it impossible that it could be sold, and yet in the course of a few hours it is all taken off, so great is the number of inhabitants. The streets connected with the market squares are numerous, and in some of them are many cold baths, attended by servants of both sexes. The men and women who frequent them have from their childhood been accustomed at all times to wash in cold water, which they reckon conducive to health. At these bathing places, however, they have apartments provided with warm water for the use of strangers who cannot bear the shock of the cold. All are in the daily practice of washing their persons, and especially before their meals. In other streets are the quarters of the courtesans, who are here in such numbers as I dare not venture to report, adorned with much finery, highly perfumed, occupying well-furnished houses, and attended by many female domestics. In other streets are the dwellings of the physicians and the astrologers. On each side of the principal street there are houses and mansions of great size. The men as well as the women have fair complexions and are handsome. The greater part of them are always clothed in silk. The women have much beauty, and are brought up with delicate and languid habits. The costliness of their dresses in silks and jewelry can scarcely be imagined. Peking, or as it was then called, Kambaluk, impressed Polo even more than Hang Chau. His millions failed him in describing its wealth and population. The 12 suburbs were yet more beautiful than the city, for there the business class had built many handsome homes. In the city proper there were numerous hotels and thousands of shops and booths. Food of all kinds abounded, and every day 1,000 loads of raw silk entered the gates to be turned into clothing for the inhabitants. Though the Khan had residences at Hang Chau, Shang Tu, and other places, the most extensive of his palaces was at Peking. A marble wall surrounded it, and marble steps led up to it. The main building was so large that dinners could be served there to great multitudes of people. Marco admired the arrangement of the chambers, the delicate and transparent glazing of the windows, and the variety of colored tiles on the roof. He had never seen so opulent a city or so magnificent a king. Doubtless the young Venetian learned to speak and read Chinese, and perhaps he learned from the official historians how Kublai and his Mongol ancestors had conquered China. The gradual drying up of the regions along the northwestern frontier into a desert land incapable of supporting its hardy population had sent the Mongols, that is, the brave, out on desperate raids to win new fields, and their successes had left them with such a taste and aptitude for war that they never stopped until nearly all Asia and parts of Europe had fallen before their arms. Story had it that their fiery leader, Genghis Khan, had been born with a clot of blood in the palm of his hand. From the age of 13 he began to weld the Mongol tribes into one, and terror was his instrument. He had prisoners nailed to a wooden ass, or chopped to pieces, or boiled in cauldrons, or flayed alive. When he received a letter from the Chinese Emperor Ning Tsung demanding his submission, he spat in the direction of the Dragon Throne and began at once his march across 1,200 miles of the Gobi Desert into the western provinces of China. 90 Chinese cities were so completely destroyed that horsemen could ride over the devastated areas in the dark without stumbling. For 5 years the Emperor of Mankind laid North China waste. Then, frightened by an unfavorable conjunction of planets, he turned back towards his native village and died of illness on the way. His successors, Ogadai, Mangu, and Kublai, continued the campaign with barbaric energy. And the Chinese, who had for centuries given themselves to culture and neglected the arts of war, died with individual heroism and national ignominy. At Juining Fu, a local Chinese ruler held out until all the aged and infirm had been killed and eaten by the besieged, all the able-bodied men had fallen, and only women remained to guard the walls. Then he set fire to the city and burned himself alive in his palace. The armies of Kublai swept down through China until they stood before the last retreat of the Song dynasty, Canton. Unable to resist, the Chinese general, Lu Xiufu, took the boy emperor on his back and leaped to a double death with him in the sea. And it is said that 100,000 Chinese drowned themselves rather than yield to the Mongol conqueror. Kublai gave the imperial corpse an honorable burial and set himself to establish that Yuan, original, or Mongol dynasty which was to rule China for less than 100 years. Kublai himself was no barbarian. The chief exception to this statement was not his treacherous diplomacy, which was in the manner of his time, but his treatment of the patriot and scholar Wen Tianxian, who, out of loyalty to the Song dynasty, refused to acknowledge Kublai's rule. He was imprisoned for 3 years, but would not yield. "My dungeon," he wrote in one of the most famous passages in Chinese literature, "is lighted by the will-o'-the-wisp alone. No breath of spring cheers the murky solitude in which I dwell. Exposed to mist and dew, I had many times thought to die, and yet through the seasons of 2 revolving years, disease hovered around me in vain. The dank, unhealthy soil to me became paradise itself. For there was that within me which misfortune could not steal away, and so I remained firm, gazing at the white clouds floating over my head, and bearing in my heart a sorrow boundless as the sky." At length Kublai summoned him into the imperial presence. "What is it that you want?" asked the monarch. "By the grace of the Sung Emperor," answered Wen, "I became His Majesty's minister. I cannot serve 2 masters. I only ask to die." Kublai consented, and as Wen awaited the sword of the executioner upon his neck, he made obeisance toward the south, as though the Sung Emperor were still reigning in the southern capital, Nanking. Nevertheless, Kublai had the grace to recognize the civilized superiority of the Chinese and to merge the customs of his own people into theirs. Of necessity, he abandoned the system of examinations for public office, since that system would have given him a completely Chinese bureaucracy. He restricted most higher offices to his Mongol followers and tried for a time to introduce the Mongol alphabet. But for the greater part, he and his people accepted the culture of China and were soon transformed by it into Chinese. He tolerated the various religions philosophically and flirted with Christianity as an instrument of pacification and rule. He reconstructed the Grand Canal between Tientsin and Hangzhou, improved the highways, and provided a rapid postal service throughout a domain larger than any that has accepted the government of China since his day. He built great public granaries to store the surplus of good crops for public distribution in famine years, and remitted taxes to all peasants who had suffered from drought, storms, or insect depredations. "Not a day passes," writes Marco Polo, "in which there are not distributed by the regular officers 20,000 vessels of rice, millet, and panicum. By reasons of this admirable and astonishing liberality which the great Khan exercises towards the poor, the people all adore him." He organized a system of state care for aged scholars, orphans, and the infirm. He patronized munificently education, letters, and the arts. Under him, the calendar was revised and the Imperial Academy was opened. At Peking, he reared a new capital whose splendor and population were the marvel of visitors from other lands. Great palaces were built, and architecture flourished as never in China before. "Now when all this happened," says Marco Polo, "Messer Polo was on the spot." This book is continued on Cassette 9, Side 1.